عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، you know, I want to start by saying that I am, inshallah, genuinely and sincerely very, very happy and very excited to be here. And sometimes this is just a generic way of starting the talk and starting the event. And, you know, I'm so happy to be with you. And he's not really happy to be, I just want to go home, you know. But I'll tell you why I'm really, really happy to be here. One time a guy took shahada and at some event. And when we were done, someone came up to me and he said, you know, when someone takes shahada, I just want to cry. How do you keep yourself from not crying? I said like this. That's how. It's not hard for me. Someone takes shahada, it doesn't move me. Yeah? So some people are moved by that. I'm not moved by that. What I'm moved by, when people come and they gather and they make their way somewhere because they want to learn something about the religion of Allah. So that's the first reason why I'm genuinely happy to see all of you. That's why I'm very happy to be here, because I know so many of you, you want to give da'wah, you want to, you know, learn the techniques of giving da'wah. So that's the first reason I'm very happy and very excited to be here. Just a little bit about myself, just so we can get to know each other better. My name is Kamal Al-Makki. Originally, I'm from Sudan. Right now I'm from Virginia, but originally I'm from Sudan. And I just actually arrived from Sudan yesterday. I'm going back when the course is over, inshallah. And, you know, Sudanese people, they're the greatest people on earth, if you're not familiar with them. And we're so good, we're such great people that the Saudis, any Saudis in the audience? Allah. I'll pretend you didn't put your hand up. Saudis are jealous of us. Yes. They're so jealous of us that they made up a lot of jokes about how lazy Sudanese people are. Yeah, sahih or not? But we're not. So they make up all kinds of jokes. And actually, I don't even want to mention these jokes. Like the one about the four lazy Sudanese guys, they robbed the bank. So they came back with the money, and they're too lazy to count it. So every 5 minutes, one of them is like, should we count the money? Ah, later. Another 5 minutes, come on, let's count the money. Ah, later. Come on, let's count the money. One of them says, why should we count the money, huh? We'll listen to the news, we're going to find out how much we got away with. See what I'm talking about? They try to say that we're lazy. They tell you that this lazy, lazy Sudanese guy walks into a barber shop. He sits down like this. Barber says, what should I do for you? He says, shave my beard. He says, okay, lift your head up. He says, you know what, just cut my hair. They tell you, Sudanese guy was lying out in his bed in the yard, so his wife knocks on the door. He doesn't want to get up because he's lazy. So he calls for his son. Son, open the door for your mother. So he says, Dad, I have exams, I'm studying here. So he tells his daughter, Yabit, open the door for your mother. She says, I'm cooking, I've got stuff to do here. So he found no one else in the house except him. He has to get up, open the door. So he yells out to his wife, I divorce you, go back to your father's house. Now, one time I'm on the plane on the way to Australia, and the guy next to me is a Saudi. He introduces himself. The minute he hears Sudan, he starts immediately cracking jokes about how lazy Sudanese are. And I'm like, I don't even know you. But he tells me this joke, but they actually now updated this joke. There's a new version of this joke. The new version is, after he tells her that, she says, okay, I'll open up my purse and take the keys out. So she had the house keys, and she's that lazy. She won't open. But, of course, we're not lazy like that. Yeah? All right, so you know what? You know who was taking Rays of Faith before? Sheikh Waleed, right? Fantastic, excellent. You know Sheikh Waleed, he has break managers?
Yes.
I have joke managers. Yeah? So we're going to need two brothers and two sisters who will be with us, inshallah. And whenever you feel that we need a break, you stand up or you put your hand up, and I crack a superb joke, inshallah. How about that? How about we pick the joke managers right now? Two brothers? Excellent. One, another brother. Another joke manager, there we go. Two sisters, joke managers. Okay, very good. One there, and another one over there. Excellent. And you know what, sisters, I'll tell you in advance, you're not going to like me very much. Because I joke a lot, and I joke about multiple marriage a lot. And I heard that's a sensitive issue here. But I have a solution for you, so it's not a sensitive issue anymore. We're going to talk about that later. I want to tell you a little bit about this course and how we came up with this idea and who read the introduction. Fantastic. Excellent. Like the first time I did this course, which is in New Jersey a few days ago, or 20 days ago, I kept saying, read the introduction. I think at the end of the course, maybe 9 people read it. So already we have 11 people who read it. That's great. A reason I insist on people reading the introduction is that you need to understand what you're going to get in this course. And many times Dawah courses, they are, or people expect Dawah courses, they expect it to be where it spoon feeds you on what to say in every possible scenario. Now as a teaching philosophy, I don't think that's fair to the student. I think it's better to equip the student with their own ability to respond to every refutation and even or to every claim or question or even things they've never heard before. We're going to do that and you're going to see it for yourself. I'm going to present you with concepts that you may have never heard of at the end of this course, and you'll be able to answer them by yourselves because you have the tools. So I want to start out by saying this is what we do inshallah in this course. We discuss the tools by which you're able to answer your own questions, by which you're able to formulate your own dawah response. For example, when you go and buy a hammer from Home Depot, when you buy a hammer, it doesn't tell you how in every possible situation you can use the hammer in. It's a tool. And you figure out, when you figure out how the tool works, you figure out where you can use it. So you might use it to drive a nail in, all right? You might use it to, you know, to do something else. You might use it to discipline your child. You become creative. You become creative with that tool. And this is what we're going to do. We're going to go over the tools and then you can apply it in different situations. And I'm going to show you sometimes where I learned the tool from, and I apply it in something absolutely different that has nothing to do with it. You know, some of these tools you can use with people, you can even use with animals. We're going to discuss a lot of things. So how do we come up with this idea, and why am I here teaching this course? It started many, many years ago when I was forced to become a chaplain of some university in Virginia. And they had a very good chaplain before me. But the dawah table was very weak. In about 2 or 3 years, they got about 2 shahadas, or maybe 3 shahadas, in 2 or 3 years. So it's about a shahada a year, all right? This was a dawah table. It consisted of books and materials and a bowl of candy, and 2 brothers sitting behind the table, hoping people will come and take some material, and people will just come, grab some candy and walk away while these 2 brothers were just talking, chit-chatting with each other. Probably about the importance of dawah and spreading the deen and all that stuff. So 2 people became Muslim in 2 or 3 years. And then the first thing we wanted to do was kind of revamp and energize the dawah table. So I put together the first ever version of a workshop. It was about 6 hours long. And we taught it at the school. And this was in the middle of the semester. So from the middle of the semester till the end of the semester, about 17 people became Muslim. And that included some of the instructors and counselors at the school and so on and so forth. So it was the first indication that you can actually then teach people some ways of giving dawah and make people into effective du'at without years of them running around the streets and talking to people and so on and so forth. So that was the first thing. So we did that. It was the first workshop and we saw these results. And then this person called their cousin and this person called their relative in the other, another state. And so this MSA then invited me for it, then that MSA and then so on and so forth. And then it became kind of a worldwide thing. So it's not like, I'm not giving the course because I'm the best da'i or anything like that. But I believe that I've put together the best approximation to what might be a quick and efficient way of giving da'wah. And this course is not just da'wah to non-Muslims. We're going to talk about da'wah to Muslims and da'wah to non-Muslims. All different kinds of people. How do we refute this person, that person, and so on and so forth. But the most important thing is that we're going to discuss some of the tools. And then you can take the tool and you can apply it in any situation that you find yourself in. And so tonight we're actually going to cover just one part of the notes. We're going to cover basically techniques of answering questions. Yeah. And perhaps then, I thought we'll go over the contents of the course together so you understand what we're going to do. So it's broken up into sections. If you open the table of contents, section one, we're going to talk about da'wah itself. And we're not going to do that tonight, obviously. And we're going to define what da'wah is. And da'wah, by the way, is, if you want to transliterate it into English, it's kind of what you see there, D-A, if you want to put the apostrophe for the ayn, W-A-H. The H is important. Because if you write da'wah as D-A-W-A, there's a problem there. That's actually now a lie in Arabic, or an allegation, a da'wah here, as a lie. So, like from yadda'i, yeah? So they allege or they lie even. So there's one da'ya, and every time I see his vehicle I feel so bad because his car, his license plate is Dawa car, D-A-W-A car. And his van is Dawa van. And every time I see it, I'm like, the lying mobile, you know. To the lying mobile. Excellent. So, we talk about the ruling on giving da'wah, and we're going to actually support the argument that says da'wah is an obligation upon everybody, because there's another argument that says da'wah is only an obligation upon certain people. If they do it, then you don't have to do it. That's one opinion. But we're not going to take that opinion. We're going to see that the evidence, inshallah, is much stronger on the other side, that da'wah is obligatory upon everybody. Then what is da'wah that's viable, that will remain? What makes it sustainable, what makes it stay and continue, not just some excitement then it dies down and so on and so forth. Then in section 2 we talk about the da'ya, which is you, the person giving da'wah. And part of one of the things we want to do in this course is that, you see, realistically everyone, we have the ability to understand people. All of us have the ability to understand people. All of us have the ability to read expressions, to understand body language, but this is the issue, brothers and sisters. Most of us, we don't put enough effort into that field. So what we're going to try to do during these 4 days is you just want to bring it up one notch, that you pay a little bit more attention to people, to understanding people. Because we all have the ability, all we have to do is just bring up our level of awareness a little higher. Okay? Like for example, if you ever watch something on TV in another language, you understand what's going on, right? You understand when they're fighting, you understand when they're worried, you understand when they're scared, and you don't understand the language, but you know it. Because because you don't understand the language, you pay close attention to expressions, to voice inflection, and you understand what's going on. So we also have the ability to understand each other, but most of the time we don't put enough effort into it. And so all I'm going to tell you is you just need to kick it up one notch. Just bring it up one notch and you'll be able to understand people. You'll understand why they're asking certain questions. You'll be able to understand why they behave in a certain way. And then we'll have certain things. Certain things will bring up a red flag. For example, a brother says something strange. Or a brother does something, the same strange thing every other day. Or does it keep saying the same strange thing to every other person that he sees. There's something behind that. We just want to bring it up, like I said, one notch, try to understand people a little better. And that's going to happen, inshallah, by the end of this course. So, part of being able to understand others is firstly understanding yourself. And that's why we talk about extroverts, introverts. We talk about something later on called a categorization of personality types. And I learned this I took this course in negotiating. Anyone here take a negotiating course? Fantastic. Excellent. Very good. So, the instructor said the closest thing I can give you to a magic wand would be the three personality types. Now, we're just going to go over it for what it's worth. And actually, there's not a single question in the exam about the three personality types. But the reason it's there is that you can use it for da'wah. And we're going to discuss how you can use it for da'wah. You know what? Everything is da'wah if you're in da'wah mode. Everything is da'wah if you're in da'wah mode. You can see anything, and because you're in da'wah mode, you see a da'wah advantage in it. Just the other day I read an article about some research that was done by a doctor in Austria, if I remember correctly. It was about picking your nose. Yeah? He's about, it's true research. This doctor in Austria, he says that it's actually very good for your health to pick your nose and eat it. And he says that it's when it's dry, yeah, eat it, he says. It's actually very good because, I love disgusting things. You'll also discover that as we move along. So he says that when you eat this material, it has in it all kinds of bacteria that has been captured by your nostrils and so on. And when it goes into your stomach, it builds up your immunity. He says it's a shame that children have this good habit and we teach them not to do it. Yeah. I remember one time when we were young, my brother, we were at a bakery. And he said there was a girl, you know how these little kids, their nose is just running all the way down like that. They have their little Hitler mustache, but it's all just snot. He said this girl just grabbed a piece of bread, she just went like this. They ate it. Fantastic. So this guy's arguing that, you know, it's good, you know, it's good for you. Eat it. If it's dry, eat it. Why not? Now, what does it have to do with da'wah? Everything. If you're in da'wah mode, everything has to do with da'wah. You know what this tells you? It tells you that sometimes facts or sometimes falsehood can have some facts and they can be accurate. But so what? True? So what? Doesn't mean because it's falsehood there's not going to be anything to support it. They're not going to have any argument. Sometimes they have a logical argument, but it doesn't make it okay. For example, one time, and I know this is one of the New Jersey students, he told me that, you know, you teach using poop a lot. He saw Brownie Surprise on the internet and things like that, yeah? So this was an atheist, very aggressive guy in where I used to work, and he was arguing very aggressively that if it's natural, there's nothing wrong with it. So he's talking about women flaunting their sexual desires and things like that. It's there, it's natural, so why not flaunt it? I told him, okay. He was being aggressive, so I had to be aggressive. I said, okay. I told him it's natural to have a bowel movement. I want you to sit up on this table right here, pull your pants down, and have a bowel movement in front of us. You're not going to do it, because not everything that's natural should be flaunted in public. He was quiet immediately. So he might come up with a fact, but that doesn't make it okay. I'll give you something else. For example, you know, some people, who's heard the end of music here? Excellent. Okay, just three people. Basically, the end of music is a lecture online about music being impermissible, right? So, some people argue that it is permissible. Why? Because it's something that's natural. And here's their argument. A little child. No one has taught this child how to dance. When they listen to music, they naturally do what? Bounce. Immediately. So they're arguing this is something natural that Allah put in us. And so they bounce, and so it can't be haram. And so, what about then? Sexual urges in teenagers. It's natural. Does that mean it's okay? It's okay, and you go ahead and act upon that? No. So the fact that you give me a piece of information or a fact, it doesn't make it okay. So falsehood sometimes can have an argument, or it can have a fact, or there can be a study. But it doesn't make it okay. And by the way, just to answer that, you know why kids bounce immediately? Because the part of the brain that's in charge of motor movements is the same part of the brain that's in charge of audio appreciation or music or things like that. That's why it's natural for the bouncing to occur. So anyways, the point is then, when you're in da'wah mode, anything that you see, anything that you hear, you can see a da'wah benefit from that. So, for the next, until the end of this course, we're going to be in da'wah mode. We're going to kick it up a notch with understanding people, and reading people, and understanding why people say certain things or do certain things. And that's going to make a huge difference for us. And that's why, you know, in order to understand people, first you understand yourself. So we talk about extroverts, introverts. You know, any salespeople in the audience? Anyone sells cars here? Okay. Okay, very good. Two people. I'm going to call on you a lot, inshallah. You're going to prove some points for us here. But I'm sure, you know, some of the people in your business, very snaky, right? Some snakes in your business, right? Now, car salesmen, they understand a lot of psychology as well. You know that if you're extroverted, how they sell you the car? They keep telling you about how people will react when they see you in the car. They say that to you because you're extroverted. So they tell you, when you park this thing in front of your driveway, say that, your neighbors are going to go crazy. People are going to look all over and say, what's this? And people are going to want to talk to you because of this car. That's how they sell you the car, based on your personality. If you're introverted, they tell you what the car will do for you. And I'll tell you an interesting statistic. They tell you that 96% of people who go to buy a new car, they end up not buying the car that they wanted. 96% of people. 96% of people who buy a brand new car, they buy a model they didn't want, they buy a brand they didn't want, the size of engine they didn't want, the color they didn't want. What does that tell you? It tells you that the salesperson can influence them that much. That much. And that's why they're so used to manipulating people. Well, of course, with the exception of our two brothers in the audience, they're so used to manipulating people that they don't listen to you. They don't care anymore. You know, I went to a dealership one time. I told the guy, now look what I asked him. He said, show me a sedan, Japanese, for under $10,000. You won't believe what he showed me. Okay? He showed me some ugly American SUV, some kind of Jimmy or Blazer. I can't stand those cars, with all respect to those who have a Blazer. Yeah. So he showed me a Blazer. So that's an SUV. And it's American, and it was for $12,000. It's just exactly the opposite of everything I asked him for. You know why? He doesn't care. He's so used to making people buy what he wants to sell. So he wasn't even listening to me. He's like, I'll make you buy this. Sometimes you hear these horrific, horrific stories about people coming in and then just totally being ripped off. And some stories are incredible. You wonder, what's wrong with these people? How could they do that to someone? The other person, how could they allow someone to manipulate them that much? So there was one story where this woman came in, and she had a very nice car, but they gave her like a $500 for her car, and she bought some new car, some other car, and she drove that for 5 days, and they called her back, they told her there's a problem, and we need to take the car back from you. She came back, gave back the new car, and they sold her back her old car for $5,000. Exactly, what? Imagine that's your wife, you're like, you did what? What you do? As a joke, I always do this to my wife when we're having a discussion or something. I always do this, then I go like that. But my wife, she doesn't mess around. She's like, come on, hit me, come on. Okay. So, talk about manners. That's so important, you know? You know, sometimes in Arabic, when someone is not well-mannered, they tell you, ما عنده أخلاق. He doesn't have manners. Even in English, this person doesn't have manners. You know, actually, akhlaq in Arabic, akhlaq is how you deal with people. That's what it means. Akhlaq is the way you treat and you deal with people. So, you can't not have akhlaq. Everyone has akhlaq. But some people have good akhlaq, some people have bad akhlaq. There's no such thing as he doesn't have manners. I mean, how could someone not have any manners? Probably someone that doesn't exist, doesn't have any manners at all. So everyone has akhlaq. They're either good or they're bad or somewhere in the middle. Because manners are akhlaq in Arabic is how you treat people. So you either treat people well, you don't treat people well. If you don't have any manners, you probably don't have anyone around you. You're probably dead or something, or live in a desert, something like that. So that's section 2, talking about the da'iyah. Section 3, we talk about the mad'u, the person that you're calling to Allah, because you need to understand that person. And here it means Muslim or non-Muslim. Muslim or non-Muslim, because people have different issues, people have different questions. Yeah, I'll tell you this, is a very simple one, it's a true story. One time someone came up to me, pulled me aside a little from the crowd, and listen to the wording now. He said, I just want to check, is weed halal? And he's doing this to me. What do you think? What do you think is going on there? It's quite clear, right? First of all, look at the language, I just want to check, and just in case, in case this is not right, yeah? Is weed halal? And usually Muslims don't say, is this halal? They say, is this haram? But he's saying, is this halal? He wants it to be, and he's nodding. Yeah? Is weed halal? And then a dead giveaway when I said, of course it's haram. He went like this. He's probably thinking, last night, haram? So that's just a very simple example, but sometimes it gets a little bit more complicated. You need to understand the person. What are they really trying to tell you? We're going to look at a lot of examples, inshallah. Is that for me? Okay. No, I want the candy. The candy. Ibn Ad?
Yeah.
MashaAllah. Sheikh's son fool around and stuff, and everyone's just nice to the Sheikh's son. Deep down, everybody's like... Okay. Section 4, we talk about, with the actually calling people. And calling people back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The techniques, the methods. We're going to discuss a lot of things. And I personally like it, if I read a book, if I take a course, I like something new, something different there. And so there's going to be some new stuff, some discussions maybe you haven't heard. Like the one there on section 4, we're going to talk about logic versus emotion. Which do people use more? Emotion, right? Psychologists tell you that 90% of your decisions are based on emotion. Yeah? So then, which does Allah use more in the Quran? Logic or emotion? Who says logic? Put your hands up. Excellent. Who says emotion? Put your hands up. Okay. Who says both? Put your hand up. Excellent. Guess what? You're all wrong. Yeah. You'll find out why tomorrow. Not tomorrow. When are we doing the logic? Next week. Yeah. Bear with me. Then we're going to discuss tools and techniques, changing people, changing behavior, why people don't change. Muslim, non-Muslim, everybody, why people don't change. We're going to look at many reasons why people don't change. Section 5, we're going to talk about religions, we're going to talk about beliefs. We're going to take care of the atheist. We're going to take care of the Trinity, it's no big deal there. But we're going to take care of the atheist. Because a lot of people are scared of the atheist. A lot of people are afraid of the atheist. They're just scared. A lot of Muslims just don't want to deal with the atheist. The atheist is easy to deal with. Don't ever be scared. Inshallah, we're going to examine their minds, why they even became atheists. We're going to talk about a lot of things, and then destroy the atheists, inshallah. And then there's, in section 5, it says at the end there, hamburgers are my lifestyle. What is that section about, you think? Anybody? Yes, sir. Close, but not. What does it mean, hamburgers are my lifestyle? Anyone want to guess? Naam? No, we're actually going to talk about homosexuality there. Why do I call it hamburgers are my lifestyle? Well, one reason is that when Al Maghrib headquarters looked at my outline, they said, you know, if you're stopped at airports and people see this, they might think you're spreading hatred against gays and everything. So I said, hamburgers are my lifestyle. Because the truth is, that's what homosexuality is. It's a desire. And a desire is never a lifestyle. True? So I desire, this is true, so I'm not making this up. I desire hamburgers. I desire hamburgers all the time. I'm happy to be in California because you have In-N-Out Burger, which is my favorite. They're the best. So I desire hamburger all the time. You can wake me up at 2 in the morning, give me a hamburger, I'll just eat it. I love hamburgers. But I don't walk around saying it's my lifestyle. You like fried chicken, it's not your lifestyle. It's a desire. Since when a desire your entire lifestyle? It's not. So we're going to look at the truth. What is really, you know, what's behind those people with the loose limbs and the ligaments and stuff? What's their issue? We're going to talk about that. You know what, my gay story goes like this. You know what a gaydar is? Yeah? See, it's your radar, your ability to detect a gay person. And some people have very strong gaydar. Who has a strong gaydar? Put your hands up. Fantastic. Okay, just one person has strong gaydar around here? But basically, I'm sure you, the minute you just take one look, you know he's gay. Immediately, right? Excellent. My younger brother is like that. Just one look, he's gay. Now for me, my gaydar is like broken. I'm giving dawah to this guy in the streets in DC. And I work him up to the shahada, right? So I ask him for the shahada. He says, I can't. My lifestyle won't allow it. I said, what is this guy talking about? He said, look man, I don't know what you mean by that. We already agreed, you agreed on everything, you have the ingredients to become Muslim. Why walk away non-Muslim? I work on him again, ask for the shahada one more time. He says, I can't. My lifestyle won't allow it. I said, listen man, I've been doing this for many, many years. No one's ever said lifestyle to me. you keep saying lifestyle. What is your lifestyle? He said, I'm gay. And only then, when he says I'm gay, do I suddenly realize a lot of things. And here I am talking to you about being perceptive and stuff. Suddenly I realize he's wearing a pink t-shirt. And he's got the gay sleeve going on. You know what the gay sleeve is? The sleeve isn't here, and it's not here either. It's like that. You know what I'm talking about? That weird gay sleeve thing. I suddenly noticed the gay sleeve, I noticed the pink t-shirt, I noticed loose limbs and stuff. I'm like, oh. So at that point, we didn't know how to deal with it. We just kept staring at him like that. And I was tempted to. I mean, even now I'm tempted to make a joke about him taking shahada but praying in the front row, but I'm not going to make that joke. Okay. So we want, you know, the truth is, it's just a desire. It's not a lifestyle, it's not a right. We're going to look at some of the arguments they present. Because everybody wants a piece of you, brothers and sisters, that's the truth. Everybody wants a piece of you. You know, one description I like of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, they said that if whenever he spoke about a topic, you felt like he spent his entire life preparing that one topic. Any topic he spoke about, you felt like it's as if that's his, like his thesis, his dissertation was just this one topic. But tomorrow he gives a lecture on another topic and you feel like he spent his whole life preparing this topic. Then he gives another lecture on another topic and you feel like his whole life was preparing this topic. Now, we can't all be like that, but we should be well-rounded. Because everybody wants a piece of you today. Everybody wants a piece of you. The atheist wants a piece of you. You know, the gay rights activist wants a piece of you. Everybody wants a piece of you. So you have to be able to answer this person, answer that person, and put this person in their place, and put that person in their place. And this is the reality. We live here. This is how it is. Everybody wants a piece of the Muslim. Muslims want a piece of the Muslim. Right? We're even going to talk about other things. We're refuting, and what kind of nice, good arguments can you give, you know, when it comes to issues of madahib and all kinds of other fiqh issues. How can you convince people? Different arguments. We're going to do all that, inshallah. Let me know when it's time to break. Yeah. So, that's yani, more or less what's in the table of God. Section 6 actually is when we discuss, you know, follow-up techniques when it comes to reverts specifically. Because a lot of work needs to be done when it comes to that. Okay. So now we're going to go over a certain area in the notes. And even if we have to break for in the middle of this section, it's not a big deal. It's just the only thing that we're going to do today. Now, but let me just talk to you a little bit about those who have attended the workshop in the past. And I actually have given it in California, probably. I've given it in this masjid. This was in 2007. I gave a 6-hour version or workshop. It was called How to Give or to Get a Shahada in 10 Minutes. I was going to say 6. Yeah. So How to Give a Shahada in 10 Minutes. This was the workshop that I was talking to you about in the beginning. This is a lot more than that. It will have some of those techniques incorporated. But this is 4 days, it's not just a 6-hour workshop. Yeah. But what about that 6-hour workshop? Yani, for those of you who are not familiar with it, who has attended that before? Excellent, great, not too many people, that's good. So, the Shahada workshop basically, I've been teaching it for the last 6 or 7 years. And there are many who have attended it and they've become superb, superb du'at. There's actually a brother in Toronto who heard it online. And he started a da'wah team, and he brought, by an early count, yani, I don't know what the numbers are today, he brought 160 people to Islam. And he retained 95% of them remain upon Islam, which is very, very high. So of his 160, 95% remain upon Islam. I got an email from my brother in Saudi Arabia, who's doing da'wah to the non-Muslims there. This was like many years ago, maybe 5 years ago or something. And he heard it online as well, and like at that point, 53 people had become Muslim from the foreigners working in Saudi Arabia. I got an email from someone in the UK, and he heard there's a 5-hour audio version of it, so it's 5 CDs. He heard the first 2.5 CDs online. This is what his email he sent me. He says, then he paused it to go out and get dinner. He says, on the way I saw a non-Muslim, so I said something from the workshop. So he gave an expected answer that was mentioned in the workshop. I gave him another answer from the workshop. He says the guy took his shahada. So he writes in his email, he says, I only listened to half the workshop and I got a shahada. What happens when I listened to the whole thing. I said, you get a shahada in 10 minutes. That's what happened. Of course, now that title, it's not a guarantee, right? It's just a marketing title, interesting title. But a lot of times people get upset, and Muslims come angry at me. How dare you? And sometimes even reverts come angry. It took me a year. You talk about 10 minutes. I'm like, yeah, it took you a year. It doesn't have to take everybody a year. It was done in 10 minutes. You know, I used to talk about this story of passing out pamphlets. I gave a guy a pamphlet. So this is a million family march in DC. We're passing out pamphlets all day. I'm walking this way, he's walking the other way. I give him a pamphlet, I keep walking. I turn around, he stopped, he's reading it. What should I do? What do you think? Now? Go back. Why should I go back to him? But what made you say go back to him? Why? Excellent. Because he's reading. Excellent. Because he's reading and he stopped. All day you give someone a pamphlet, just take it, they keep walking. This man stopped. So as a da'i, you read these signs. So he stopped, there's something there. I just walked back to him. I still haven't said a word. When I got there, he said, okay, what do I do now? I said, for what? He said, to become Muslim. I said, you know that it's serious and you can't leave. And he said, yes, I know all that. What do I do? He took his shahada right then and there. It wasn't even 10 minutes, it wasn't even 10 seconds. Gave him the pamphlet and he wants to become Muslim. I'm that good, by the way. No, it has nothing to do with me. And it could have been anyone else in this audience. It's just that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts you at the right place at the right time. Maybe this person's been searching for months. Maybe he's been reading. Maybe he read half the Quran already. Maybe this was just the last straw. That he's been thinking about Islam and suddenly a Muslim gives him a pamphlet and he took it as a sign maybe. You know? So, it's possible. And there have been a lot of people who have taken the course and they've become excellent du'at and they've had great results and so on and so forth. One time a 15-year-old took the workshop. This was, like I said, the 6-hour version. And next day his best friend became Muslim. And he even writes, he says that he's better than a lot of Muslims now, you know. So, it's possible. So, yani, what I'm trying to tell you is that the short version worked so well for so many people and there's so many success stories, alhamdulillah. What happens with the full version? Inshallah khair happens. I'm not going to say, give you minutes or anything like that. Okay, so we're on page 62 of the notes. We're going to discuss, that's all we're going to do tonight, 9, if we can get to the 9, or 6 actually, 6 techniques of answering questions. Okay, why this section specifically? I'll tell you. First of all, that a lot of Muslims think their job as a da'iyah is just to answer questions. You talk a little bit about Islam, any questions, and then the guy starts to ask you all kinds of ridiculous questions and you just answer. And you just answer. And of course you have to acknowledge all questions as intelligent questions and then respond. And so you, sometimes what happens is you might be in a bad place here. So for example, the first question, why does God need us to worship Him? See that question? And it's a common question. Why does God need us to worship Him? Don't start answering this question. Because if you start answering it, no matter how you answer it, you're wrong. True? No matter how you answer. Because Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ, you're wrong. Because Allah is so great and so magnificent that He's deserving of being worshipped, you're wrong. Why? What's wrong with the question? Look at that question. Why does God need us to worship Him? And the truth is, Allah does not need us to worship Him. If you don't fix the question first, no matter how you answer it, you're telling them, this is why Allah needs us to worship Him. So first thing you have to do is, fix the question. Number two, can God create a four-sided triangle? And here people get excited. Yes, yes, of course He can. Yes, He can. And what's funny? There's no such thing as a four-sided triangle, unless you're an idiot. That's a square or a rectangle. This triangle has three sides. So don't accept this premise. It's wrong. I'm just going to say, yes, of course He can create a four-sided triangle. He can even make it 15 sides. In your eye also He can create it. No, Habibi. There's no such thing as a 15-sided triangle. It's not a triangle anymore. Why should I accept this premise? Number three, an atheist asks, this one is a little more tricky. What is it about the Quran that makes you so sure that there is a God? What is it about the Quran that makes you so sure there is a God? Now, I was asked this question recently by two atheists, and they kept repeating it. I didn't know how to answer this question. I just found it difficult to answer. And then I realized why I found it so difficult to answer. Because, I mean, I didn't know where to start. Because they're starting from the wrong platform. They're assuming there is no God, so what's your proof there is? But I'm saying there's so much evidence in the Quran. Yani, where do I start? Is it from the science? Or is it from the knowledge of the future? Or is it from the grammar in the Quran? Or is it from the perfect solutions to problems? Or is it from just the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's proof that he was a genuine prophet of Allah? Where do I start? But he's assuming that he's right, and so what's your proof? Yeah? طيب, so it says there in the notes, no matter how well you answer question number one, you will always be affirming that God needs us to worship Him. You need to fix the question first before you proceed. So the rule is, do not immediately accept the person's premise, or you may be at a disadvantage. I think everyone sees how that applies now. All kinds of ridiculous questions will come at you. You know the one about the rock, right? Can God create a rock that is so big that nothing, no living thing can move it? And immediately your answer is, yes. And then they say, can God move it? And if you say yes, you're in trouble, because that means He cannot create a rock that is so big that no living thing can move it, if He can move it. And if you say no, He can create a rock so big that He can't move, so you're in trouble. So the best answer to it is, I think that's coming up. We'll come back to it. Okay, so the first technique of answering questions, I call it the flip side of the argument. Okay, you give the opposite side and it makes it clear to people. You flip it around and it becomes clear to people why, first of all, why the question is wrong, for example. So you get them to think of the opposite of this argument, and you get them to understand why their question is incorrect to begin with. So, question A, why do Muslims grow their beards? And actually a non-Muslim once asked me this question. I used to work at a company where there were many Muslims. He noticed the Muslims had beards. So he asked me, I want to ask you, why is it that Muslims always grow their beard? And my answer was, I understand why you're asking me that question. Meaning, considering the environment in which we live. I said, but I actually don't grow it. It comes out by itself. True or false? It's not like I wake up and put some manure, and go outside in the sun, check, is it growing? Huh? Is it growing? It just comes up by itself. So I told him, because what is natural is when a male matures, he develops facial hair. I told him, if you ask a child now to draw the face of a man and the face of a woman, the child will naturally add facial hair to the face of the man. Because when a man develops, he naturally produces facial hair. So what is natural is for your hair to grow out. But what is not natural is to insist every morning on removing every stubble of hair and cutting yourself in the process and putting the cologne and sticking the little tissues all so you can say, ah, like that guy in the Gillette commercial. Yeah. So, when I said this to him, guess what he said? Because I could have told him it's the way of all the prophets of Allah and all the prophets had beards. But you know what? When I said that to him, you know what he said? He said, you know what? I never thought of that. I shouldn't ask you why you grow your beard. You should ask me why. So, what happens here? We're using this technique. You flip the question around, and suddenly they understand what's so clear about it. You know, why are Muslim women covered? That's the second one. And this is a true story. There was a sheikh giving a lecture. It was a room where men on the right, women on the left. And then, a non-Muslim woman came in very angry, yelling out loud in the middle of this event. She's pointing at the Muslim woman. Why are they covered? And you know what they mean, right? Muslim women are covered, they're oppressed, yeah? Everyone else is covered, it's okay. The nun is covered, it's because she's, you know, keeping herself pure. But the Muslim woman is covered because she's oppressed. So she came in angrily yelling, why are they covered like that? So the speaker said to her, now he's getting to flip it, yeah, flip the flip side. He said, well, I see that you're covered also, and you're clothed, but you were born naked, why are you covered? So she said, modesty. He said, well, modesty? More modesty. Khalas. It makes sense. If covering is modesty, that means the more you cover, the more modest you are. You know what, you can flip it around more, but I don't recommend you ever use this, yeah? But the argument is that if you're covered, that means you're oppressed. That means the more uncovered you are, the more liberated you are. So you could, essentially you could tell a woman, well, I see that you are not fully liberated at the moment, why don't you liberate yourself some more? You're not going to use that, yeah? But that would be the same thing. Well, you're not fully liberated either. You know? When you're totally liberated, then come talk to me. We can discuss. So, the Qur'an is created and not the word of Allah. And this is what those of you who know the biography of Imam Ahmad and the fitna and all that, the mihna. This was the argument of the people who are like the Mu'tazila. They're saying that, and see look, when you hear the argument, it sounds like they're trying to respect Allah. But when you flip it around, it becomes a problem. And that's how he defeated them in many debates. He flipped it around on them. So they said that Allah is qadim, and he's ancient, that he's been there for a long time. And speech is something renewable. So it's not befitting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being al-qadim, he has a renewable attribute. And people speak. So how can people speak and Allah speaks? And the ayah says in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like him. So how can people speak and Allah speaks? So they concluded, Allah doesn't speak. So he got them at one point, he flipped it on them. You're saying that because people speak, Allah can't speak. So then he said, do you have knowledge? The man was quiet immediately. Because if you have knowledge, and Allah has knowledge, and nothing is like Allah, that means either you don't, if you have knowledge, Allah doesn't have knowledge. And actually one of them at some point in the debate, he said, yes, at some point Allah didn't have knowledge. So Imam tells him, kafart. You've become a disbeliever. So then the guard, there was a guard, just an ignorant person standing, so he got angry. He says, how could you say that to the messenger of Amir al-Mu'mineen? Because he was sent by the Khalifa. So how could you say that to him, that he is not a Muslim? So Imam Ahmad tells this simple guard, he's saying that Allah had no knowledge until he created his knowledge. And how could Allah create his own knowledge without having any knowledge? And he said, the narrative says, the guard then angrily looked at the other guy. How dare you? So he flipped it around on them. Yeah? So, flipping the argument around. Sometimes people tell you Allah is not on his throne. Even until now, Muslims, they'll be amongst us and they pray with us. They say Allah is not on his throne. Now look how they make it sound respectful. If you say Allah is on his throne, you're physically limiting Allah. You see this word? It makes the Muslim guilty. You're physically limiting Allah if you say he's on his throne. Don't physically limit Allah. Where did you get this term from, physically limiting? But they just make you ashamed. Don't say Allah's on his throne. If you say that, you're physically limiting him. But what's the flip side of that? The flip side is that he's physically everywhere. And these people until now, they never answer the question, is he in the bathroom? They stay quiet. Is he in the church? They stay quiet. Is he in other places that you wouldn't be caught dead in these places? They're quiet. Is he in the bar? They're quiet. So, if you don't want to say he's on his throne, and by the way, Allah said he's on his throne, 6 times in the Quran, he's on Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa. He's on his throne. So if he's not on his throne, then the flip side of your argument is worse. He's everywhere. And that's why many Muslims historically have gone astray concerning this issue. And even wrote poetry saying, وَمَا الْكَلْبُ وَالْخِنْزِيرُ إِلَّا إِلَهُنَا. And the dog and the pig is nothing but our God. How can a Muslim say that? Could you believe a Muslim would say, the dog and the pig is our God? You wouldn't believe that, right? But they did. Why? Because it started off with this concept. Initially trying to respect Allah, but the flip side of it was worse than what they were trying to avoid in the beginning. Because now, the pig takes up space, the dog takes up space, and if God is in everything, then he's inside. Allah is far removed from that. Then he's inside this space. And they said, even the monk in the monastery is our God. One of them, instead of saying Subhanallah, said Subhani, Subhani. Yeah? Because I'm God, God's in me. That's why a lot of these deviant groups, they respect and they treat people very nicely. Why? Not because of akhlaq, because God is in them. They believe that. They believe Allah is in you. So if I hit you, I'm hitting him. So I have to be nice to you. That's why they're nice to people. So they got in more trouble by trying to avoid something simple. The flip side was worse here. Why do bad things happen to good people? That's a question you get many times from Muslims, from non-Muslims, mostly from non-Muslims. He said 5 minutes for Salah. Naam? 2 minutes for Salah. Why do bad things happen to good people? Who can flip that around for us? That will stop for Salah. Why do bad things happen to good people? Okay, why do good things happen to bad people? I like that. It's a good flip. There's another one. It gets people to think. And you're worried, why do bad things happen to good people? Why do good things happen to bad people? No, nothing good should happen to them. What's another? You can flip it around by saying, well, how much intervention do you want? And if there's a good person, nothing bad should happen to them at all. They're about to slip, suddenly there's a big feather pillow underneath them. They're falling off a ladder, there's a big pillow, a big mattress under them. Posturpedic even, not just any mattress. Ma'am? Uh-huh. So now you look at it from another angle, from patience, from the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, from the tests in this life, and so on and so forth. But you just flip it around. Would you want God to intervene in everything? So if you're a good person, nothing happens to you, never get scratched, you know, never fall, nothing breaks. How much intervention do you want in life? Okay, we'll stop here. We'll continue inshallah after Salah. Jazakumullah khairan, sallallahu mubarak wa Muhammad, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So we were talking about the different ways of answering questions. First thing we established is don't just accept the question. If there's something wrong with the question, fix it first. Don't start proceeding based on that premises. That's the first thing. First technique we discussed, you flip the question around, get them to think about it. So the one last one we were doing, is people ask you, and this happens many times, why do bad things happen to good people? Their argument is that, if someone's good, nothing bad should happen to them. So realistically, all you have to do is get them to extend that argument further. Push that argument, get them to push it, and they'll see that it's just they're asking for an impossible world. They're asking for a euphoria where nothing goes wrong, nobody slips and falls, and no one gets hurt or scratched or cut. So that's Jannah, that's later. They're asking for Jannah right now. When you push the argument, they get to realize what's wrong with it. So like some of you reversed it, why do good things happen to bad people? Guy's a criminal and stuff and good things happening for him. Robs a bank, gets away with it and spends the cash and something, that's something good, according to them. It shouldn't happen to him. Or you flip it around and just ask them, how much intervention do you want? Every time something bad's about to happen, you want God to intervene. You know, protect this person and stop that from happening, stop that from happening. Again, that's Jannah, that's later. You're asking for Jannah on earth then. So you flip the argument around. Page 63, the other way, another way of answering questions, another technique is that you use facts. And we all do this, it's not like we're learning anything new. And a lot of times what we do in this course is we unlearn the wrong way of giving da'wah. We unlearn the wrong way of giving da'wah. Many ways that we think that this is how you give da'wah, we find out that no, it's not the best way actually. So, you use facts. So many statements are factually and historically inaccurate. So you use the facts to refute claims and answer questions. So for example, on page 63, the first one says that more people die because of religion than anything else on earth. How many times have you heard that? You heard that before? Many times non-Muslims say that to you. And you're at a da'wah table and someone tells you, no, sorry, I don't talk about religion because religion is responsible for more death than anything else. And how do you refute that? Yeah, you use facts. Yeah, it's inaccurate. So you start looking at wars around the world and throughout history, and then you start to see that first of all, the majority of them were not about religion, or they were about, you know, money, taking over people's land. And even those that are about religion, it wasn't just about religion. They brought religion in as one of the factors. So, World War I, how many people died? 25 million. World War II? 50, some estimates go as high as 60 some million. And this was just, you know, one war. and it didn't really have much to do with religion. There was some ideology involved, but it wasn't a religion. So what about all the other wars, the Prussian Wars, the Hundred Years' War, all these civil wars, millions of people dying, just Napoleon, you know how many, he got a million of his own people, just his own soldiers, not counting those that they killed. Just a million of his own men died. What was he doing? What was that all about? It wasn't about religion. You know, go up to the Alps, it gets too cold, he goes to Egypt for the summer. And so, when you do the math, more people die because of land and money than anything else. So that means that next time that person has a job interview and they ask him how much would you like to be making, he should stop the interviewer and say, sorry, I don't talk about money. More people die because of money than anything else on earth. Yeah? So it's actually not true. B, why do you cut off the hand of the thief? And this is as a ruling, I mean, not, maybe it's not being practiced too much now. One time I saw some kind of interfaith thing on television. It was basically really an opportunity to gang up on the Muslim. So they brought some girl from university, young girl, they put her on this panel, and everybody turned on her. You guys cut off the hand of the thief, and that's barbaric, and how dare you. And so she started to immediately apologize. She said, we don't do that anymore, only one country is doing it. And you should have just added, inshallah, they'll stop soon, you know? So, how can you use facts here? Using some facts or any incident, anything. And
number of prison and the number of people in the prison.
Excellent. Excellent. Excuse me. So here now we can use facts. So they're assuming that, you know, prison is better than this, that the Sharia prescribed punishment. So if someone steals, you put them in jail. But then there are many problems with that. Many problems with that. You know, for one, if somebody steals something and you put them in jail, you're not just punishing him. You're punishing a number of people, right? If, you know, if that person's married, you're punishing his wife. Or maybe you're giving her a treat, depending on, all right, sisters? So, you're punishing the wife, the parents, the children. All these people are not going to see this individual anymore. Then they go to jail, and then they're treated really, really badly there. And then you can look at other statistics. For example, like 82% of people who leave prison, they return. So that means it doesn't rehabilitate. It's very bad. Yeah. Actually, one time a friend of mine, he used to give a halaqah at the prison. So one time he asked the prisoners, he said, who in here would rather have their hand cut off today and be with their family tomorrow? What do you think is of the percentage of people who put their hands up? What do you think? Every single one of them. 100% of them put their hands up. Yeah, take it off. I want to be with my family tomorrow. This place is a nightmare. They don't even get the prescribed punishment. Yani, someone stole and the judge says, your punishment is that you're kept away from society for 15 years. But is that the only punishment that he gets? No. And he's beaten, he's attacked, he's insulted, and it's legal to beat him up really bad and stuff. All these things, we're talking about human rights and all this is happening here. And so it has become a big business, you know. You know, since the 80s, like spending on public schools and on education has increased by 74% since the 80s until now. But on prisons, 314%. So it's business. And these people go and they come back again, and it just gets worse and worse and worse. So the cutting off the hand of the thief, it's a deterrent, and it works. For decades in Islamic history, there were only six hands that were cut. Just six hands that were cut. Compared to, now if you want to use statistics, you know, every 16 seconds, a car is stolen. Every 18 seconds, a house is broken into. Every 6 seconds, a woman is assaulted. We're talking about seconds now. Seconds. Versus, you know, 70 years, 100 years, six hands being cut only. And by the way, the Sharia is not bloodthirsty. I mean, a lot of people, even Muslims, they imagine that the Sharia, like the state, wants blood, you know? Like that's how it operates. Remember as a kid, there was this movie, this guy goes to Turkey and he steals an orange. And they capture him, and they bring him to this place in the market where all these people are just standing around and they're cheering as people's hands get cut off. Like these are just regular Muslims, they're just standing there, and then, you know, the camera cuts away and you just hear hand being cut, and all these Muslims go, ah, they're so happy. Like, is this a Muslim state? People just want to see blood? Like, hey, you free? let's go watch some hands being cut off. Yeah, let's go. We go and just like, yes! And they're so happy that the hand was cut. And plus, do you cut off the hand for an orange in Islam? It's just all inaccurate. The Islamic State is not bloodthirsty, yeah? And even when you look at the rulings for zina and things like that, the idea isn't to try to get people punished. Yeah? And even if you look at the stipulations for establishing like proof that someone has committed zina, they're very difficult. Yeah? Like four witnesses, and these witnesses have to have seen something very, very specific. Any, not just movement, but very specific. You know, like, and they have to have seen Pennsylvania and Virginia. You understand? That's, and then they have to be four upright and righteous individuals. Like, you're going to find four mashayikh, or like, where are you going to find this, yani? It doesn't happen like that. So the idea isn't to try to just get people. You know, the state, the Muslim state isn't out to get people. Right? You know the story of the woman who committed zina. She came to the Prophet and he turned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he turned from her. She came again, he turned this side. Or the man who came to the Prophet, he says, I committed zina. Prophet turned away from him. He came from the other side. One more time, Prophet turned away from him. The third time, Prophet turned away from him. Then he asked him, Abika Junoon, are you crazy? And do you have any mental issues? And he asked his people, about his tribe, about him. In one narration, he had someone smell his mouth to see if he's drunk. In one narration, and he also tells him, La'allaka qabbalt, perhaps you just kissed her. And he says, no, I actually did what a man does with his wife. He's being very specific here. But the idea, especially if someone is going to testify against themselves, they're actually encouraged in court not to testify against themselves. They're encouraged not to testify against themselves. That's why judges would say, would ask someone, Asaraqt? Qul la. Did you steal? Say no. He's telling him the answer. Don't testify against yourself. It's not like the state is bloodthirsty or anything, but that's the image you get in Hollywood. That's what a lot of Muslims think, that it's just this barbaric state that wants to see limbs fly, wants to see blood and stuff. But it's a very good deterrent. You know, I always use the example of the drug dealer in Saudi Arabia. What happens to the drug dealer in Saudi Arabia? Yeah, it's executed. That's great. I think we should do that in the United States. And then how many cool drug dealers will be driving their vehicles with their heads cut off? It'd be excellent. Nobody would want to be a drug dealer. Yeah, he's got spinners on his car, but no head. Fantastic. Great deterrent, you know? And subhanAllah, these people, they encourage Yani. There was one drug dealer in New York City. He used to make $60,000 a day from one corner, and he had multiple corners. They say because of this one guy, he was a young guy, he's very popular, he's in jail now. Yeah? Because of him, tens of Shabab went to jail, because everyone was trying to be like him. But if his head was cut off, nobody would want to be like him. You know, it's a good deterrent. You should consider that here. Maybe you guys in California can start it, yeah? California, forget about it. So then what happens is people try to shame you and put you in the corner and get you to apologize for the religion of Allah. So our system works. It's been proven to work. It's a good deterrent. And that's how it works. It's scary and it's a deterrent, yeah? Nobody wants their hand cut off, so it's not worth stealing. But there's also another side to it. Yani, there's the side where yani, the taqwa, you know, being God conscious, that's the first reason you don't want to steal. Then the second, for those who are not, you don't have enough yani, taqwa, is there's a strong physical deterrent. And that's why it works. That's why in Islamic history there were times when you would leave money and 3 days later you find it there. Yeah. Any of you ever study the laws of luqata, yani, when you find something on the floor? Anybody? Any one of the courses? You ever study that? You never pick up anything off the floor. You don't want to deal with that. It's a huge responsibility, you know? So that's how people work. So, you can use facts to respond to a question or to answer questions. By the way, for the first one, there's another very strange one. I'll just mention it for what it's worth, yeah? And a lot of times, and actually I've never, I mostly get this question from Muslim sisters. They say, why is it that a man can marry four and a woman can't marry four? Are you serious? Did you even think about this question? Did you even think about it? You know where this question comes from? It comes from the radical feminist movement. See, the feminist movement isn't all bad, yani. And for example, who in here believes that if a man and a woman have equal skills, equal level of education, they should get the same salary? Come on, brothers. Yeah. So now you're all feminists. It's not a bad thing. That's what a feminist is. But you know why we think of it in a bad way? Because there's something called radical feminism. There's liberal feminism, social feminism, there's radical feminism. Radical feminists, these are the crazy ones. These are the ones that, you know, say, why is it his story and not her story? And they actually want to spell women, W-O-M-Y-N, women. They say they want to take the men out of women. Crazy. Take the men out of women. What kind of life would that be? So the point is they're the ones that are crazy. So their goal in life is to be like the man. Whatever the man does, we have to do. He's a bus driver, we're bus drivers. He's a firefighter, we can be firefighters. He was a boxer, we'll box also. So their only goal in life is to be like the man. So if the man can do it, we should be able to do it. And that's the way they're thinking. They just want to compare themselves to the man. They want to be like the man, as if being a man is such a great thing. It is, brothers, isn't it? Come on. It's great, isn't it? Just kidding, sisters. You know, there's a dua in the Jewish religion. When they wake up, the man thanks Allah for not being born a woman. You know that? Can you imagine that, sisters? Astaghfirullah. That's the only thing in the Jewish religion I agree with, actually. kidding, sisters. Sisters are already getting upset. You know my policy with upsetting sisters when I travel somewhere? In a few days I leave and you have to deal with that. So, no, sisters, we'll be friends tomorrow, sisters. They always get upset with me on the first night. Tomorrow we'll be friends, inshallah. Then I don't even believe it. You're looking this way, you can't see their expressions now. Some of them are saying, Alhamdulillah, I didn't pay for this yet. I can leave. Okay. So, where were we here before we got... we were talking about the radical feminist movement. And so they just want to be like the men. Whatever the man does, want to be like the man. So this has affected even Muslim women living in the West. So they'll come up to you and ask you such a ridiculous question. Why can't a woman marry four? Are you serious? Did you even think about this question? Did you even think about it? So what is this, yani? She marries four, then she has to cook and clean for four maybe, and then she has to bear children for four men, and it's just impossible, and it's very dirty too, yani. What kind of a question is that? Then they also ask you things like, well, how come there wasn't a female Prophet of Allah? Now, does that make women any less, yani, or would women be any better if there was in the past a female Prophet? Is it just like, oh, there was a male, there has to be a female? No, not necessarily. Actually, it wouldn't be a good deal to have a female prophetess of Allah. It doesn't even sound right. But it wouldn't be a good deal at all. It's an unfair thing. She has to, where is the prophetess of Allah? Yeah. Allah, she's, it's that time of the month, she can't lead the salah. Someone else, okay, brother, you lead. Yeah? And then she has to go out on these expeditions, walking for 2 months, you know. And she could be pregnant during that time. And they're like, everybody's helping her up, and she's like, you know, pregnant, oh, hey, are you okay? And labor pains, you know, asbari, have patience and trust in Allah, you're a prophet. Just doesn't make any sense. But people just, that's all they think about. The man does it, we have to do it. So who said the man is a role model for women? I'll tell you something else, it's a quote, one of the scholars said, to treat two different things as equal is a form of injustice. One more time. To treat two different things as equal is a form of injustice. True or false? Very true. Let's just simplify it. You know, you work at some kind of warehouse. You take these big 100-pound sacks and you drop them. You know, a couple of feet, these big burly men. They grab it, they walk away. Then a 14-year-old girl comes. She goes like this, throw me one. And you think to yourself, okay, well, you know, treat them all as equal, inshallah. I'm an equal opportunist. And you just drop it on her and you crush her. To treat two different things as equal is a form of injustice. So and don't just ask, well, how come the man, you know, there hasn't been a female prophet? It would be very unfair. It would be a very difficult situation for her, you know? And then if someone marries this prophet of God, this woman, who's the boss then in the house? You know? Huh? The man, right? But then Allah revealed something, then what? Like, I know Allah revealed this ayah to you, but I say stay home today. You can't leave. Problems. Okay. Alright, let me try to become friends with the sisters again. By the way, did you guys hear the joke about the dumb brothers who said no? It didn't work, sisters, I'm sorry. I tried. I tried to make fun of the brothers. Okay, number three. You always start with the simplest explanation first. That's another rule when you answer questions. You start with the simplest explanation. I know a lot of brothers, they love long-winded explanations. And one time I said, I asked a group of Muslims, okay, how do you answer this question to a non-Muslim? You have explained to them that there are two types of the qadr and irada of Allah. Are you serious? Just give the simplest explanation first. If it works, alhamdulillah, you move on to your topic. If it doesn't work, then you can go to a more sophisticated one. This is for Muslims or non-Muslims as well. Sometimes even with a Muslim, they ask you a question, you just give them a simple analogy, they understand it, they move on without going into great detail. So if you can suffice with the simple one, go with the simple one first. So we look at a specific example here, and this might deal with a Muslim or a non-Muslim in our times now. The question is, why is the apostate killed in Islam? Why is the apostate killed in Islam? And I'd like to mention something here that's... it's a common mistake. What's the verb form when someone leaves Islam in English? What is it? Naam? Yeah, the verb form that someone has. I see a lot of this. That's why I mentioned it. A lot of times people think it's apostated. There's no such word as apostated. Yeah, the verb form is actually strange. It's apostatized. So when you leave Islam, you apostatize. You don't apostate. Apostate is a noun. Yeah, it's the act of abandoning one's religion. Or apostasy is the act of abandoning one's religion. Apostate is the person who has abandoned their religion. And to apostatize is the verb form. So why do you kill someone if they apostatize? That's the question. So now here, and this is actually a true story, this was a missionary in our school. It was someone who teaches Bible study. So he came and asked me this question. Now, I know that he's just trying to embarrass me because of a number of things. One, because of the fake look of concern on his face. That was the first giveaway. The second is that he was just a few minutes ago telling me about his friends who are missionaries in Morocco, and they're trying to convert people there, and he was angrily telling me that they're not successful because you guys, you know, you killed the apostate. So he says, why do you kill someone if they leave Islam? So now I have three answers for him in my head, okay? But I'm just trying to prove this point, that I wanted to start off with the simplest one first. And if it doesn't work, I can go to the next one. And if it doesn't work, I can go to the next one. But if the simplest one works, I can move on to my main point, which is discussing Tawheed with this person. So I asked him a simple question, one sentence, and he immediately said, I understand. I said, okay, what is the punishment for treason? And he said, I understand. That was it. Is that simple? Start with the simple one first. Because he understood now that if someone leaves their allegiance to their country, the ruling is, they should be killed. Right? I think just this year, or that they just changed it in Canada. 2 years ago they changed it in Australia. But in the good old US, it's still, I think, the same. Yeah. So if someone leaves their country, they should be killed. So if they leave their allegiance to Allah Azza wa Jal, nothing happens. So the minute I made the comparison, he said, I understand. But you know what? Suppose he didn't like that comparison. Said, I don't like that. Still, I don't agree. I don't even agree with treason. But I have something else for him. And because he teaches Bible study, I had for him Deuteronomy, the book of Deuteronomy in the Bible, chapter 13, verse 8 and 9. Which basically is the same ruling in his own book. And you teach this book and you're asking me this question. So I was going to quote it for him, but we didn't have to go there. But I was going to tell him, Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 8 and 9. Because there it's different. There it's a mess. There it says, the one who leaves his religion, you know, kill him and let your hand be the first to reach him. And you be the first one to kill him. So you pray Isha, salamu alaykum, salamu alaykum. Asma, did you hear about Brother Hassan? Let's go pay him a quick visit, yeah? And so, according to the Bible, you want your hand to be the first. But the moment he opens the door, right? So, by the way, in Islam, of course, you know it's a very different system. It's not like someone, you hear that someone leaves Islam and you just go get him and stuff like that. First of all, it's done by the authorities. There are procedures and steps involved. First of all, they talk to him, yeah, about, the scholars really refute any doubts that he has on the issue, and they can spend days with him, refuting and arguing with him, trying to convince him. Then they might even and they threaten him with the sword. They tell him, you need to repent from this, because if you don't repent, you will be killed. And if he insists on being killed, that means he's really, really believing in that. And then, yani after the procedures take their toll, and then at the end, by the authority of the ruling body, it's done. It's not just like in brothers after Isha go visit someone, stuff like that. So it's not like, but according to the Bible, just, you know, let your hand be the first to strike him, yeah? So it's different. And I have to say this, because one time in our area, there was a brother who reverted to Islam, and then he left Islam in about a week or two. So one other brother, and he was also revert, subhanAllah, he said, oh, he left Islam? You know, I'm going to take him out hunting, we're going to have an accident. Yeah, he really thought it was his job, yeah. And he was like, brother, go check if that a deer over there, and you, boom. He's going to pull a Dick Cheney on that guy. So it's not how it's done at all. Yeah. So that was the second argument I had ready for him. But I didn't have to go there, because the simplest one worked, alhamdulillah. But even if he didn't like that one, I had another one for him. Right? This is verse 72 or 73 in Surah Al-Imran. وَقَالَ الطَّائِفَةُ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ آمِنُوا بِالَّذِي أُنزِلَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَجْهَ النَّهَارِ وَكْفِرُوا آخِرَهُ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ So this was a plot by the Jews of Medina. When Islam entered Medina, they would pretend to enter into Islam in the morning. So 10, 12 people would become Muslim in the morning. Then at night they leave. Same night they leave Islam. Tomorrow a group becomes Muslim. Then the same day they leave Islam. Towards the end of the day they leave Islam. So what happens to the non-Muslim or the non-Jewish Medinian who is contemplating perhaps becoming a Muslim? He sees that it's not worth becoming a Muslim. There's no substance there. People leave their religion the same day. Groups just enter and leave the same day. You know, if you leave in a month, maybe you discovered something. But if you leave in a day, that means there's just nothing there. So they tried to do that to deter people from becoming Muslim. It was a technique. Then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, مَنْ بَدَّلَ دِينُهُ فَاقْتُلُهُ The one who changes his religion, kill him. How many people you think pretended to be Muslim the next day? Zero. Nobody wanted him, because then there's killing involved. So that was my third explanation for him. So the first one didn't work, use the second one, use the third one. But so what we try to do is start with the simplest one. Because I want to move on to something more important. Yeah, unless that's the only issue. It could be a Muslim, and they might ask you that, and I might start in this case from the third one. Right? Because if it's a Muslim asking me this question, I don't have to do number two, I don't have to quote the Bible. I don't have to maybe give the comparison with treason. I'll just start with number three immediately. If it's a non-Muslim, I might follow these steps. Yeah? Anyone want to add anything to that? And by the way, I always say this, feel free to disagree with me. Feel free also to take and leave from most of the things that I say. For the most part, a lot of the things we discuss are suggestions, yeah? And suggested methods and techniques. And you as a da'i, you see, in this situation that I'm in, what is the best method to use? So you draw on or you pull from any of these, and you might use it in that situation. And feel free to disagree with me, okay? You can put your hand up and disagree. There's no problem with that. You don't have to just agree with me because, you know, I came from overseas or an instructor or anything like that. Feel free to disagree. But if you're going to disagree, just have some kind of evidence or some kind of study. And I'll accept it. And the reason I insist on these two things is that one time a guy was just disagreeing with me on my most important point. And in the end I asked him, okay, what are you basing this on? He says, I'm guessing. So, we can't have any of that, right? Alright, so that was number three. Number four, explain the concept and the purpose behind something. So, I'm reading from the notes, sometimes it's hard to understand the details without the bigger picture. Make sure you explain the reasons and wisdoms before you proceed. So for example, someone says, and this is sometimes even from Muslims, how could your Prophet ride on a winged horse? They're talking about Buraq really, on winged horse and things like that. So how could you believe that your Prophet rode on a horse that, you know, flies to Bayt al-Maqdis or what have you? How do you answer that? Who wants to go? Sisters, anybody? Yes, sir. What's the big deal? And if Allah created the heavens and the earth, if there is a God, if He is a genuine Prophet, now is this a difficulty now? And if Allah created the heavens and the earth, just moving someone from point A to point B, is this a big deal? You know, Muslims will ask you many times, How can you believe the story of Jibreel alayhi salam coming down, opening the chest of the Prophet salam, taking his heart out, washing it, putting it back in, and then they tell you things, look what they say, with no anesthesia, no stitching. Are you serious? Well, how do you answer this one? It's simple. I just say, consider the surgeon. Look who's doing the surgery. That's all. Yeah, and if you tell me Dr. Chowdhury did it, then okay. Like, okay, that's, I don't believe that. But Shadeed al-Quwa, the most powerful of the angels, Jibreel, the archangel, alayhi salam, he is the surgeon. I have believe it. It's not a, and if you can believe in Jibreel alayhi salam, 600 wings and each one of them would cover the horizon, it's easy for me to believe this. So if you consider the surgeon, it makes sense. Look at the bigger picture here. Tell me anesthesia and all that stuff. Who is the surgeon? Right? Anyone want to add to that? I thought I saw someone's hand up. Okay. So, another person says, let me give you this one. This is also a true story. Someone came up to me and he said, why does God care if I eat pork or not? He used to eat pork, this guy. He was born Muslim, yani, but he says, why does God care if I eat pork or not? Shouldn't God care about big things like if I murder someone, if I steal, if I lie? Why does He care if I look at the menu and I order number 9 and it has pork in it? You see? How do you answer that? Give me the bigger picture, somebody. Naam? He doesn't? But He doesn't allow it, yani, is what He's trying to say. Yani, it's not acceptable and it's punishable, right? Khalid,
football. He doesn't care about that if you murder everything else. But not to be exclusive, but even if you do these things like eat pork, drink alcohol, you're still not committing to what He told you to do. That's what He's
thinking. Ahsan. Very good. So that's the bigger picture. So when you, it's sure, the act of saying, give me number 9 and paying for it, the act is simple. But it comes under a bigger umbrella, a bigger picture. That is, you're disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't matter how simple the act was, right? You know the saying of the early Muslims, لا تنظر إلى صغر المعصية ولكن انظر إلى عظمة من عصيت. Right? Don't look at how small the sin is, but look at the greatness of the one you're sinning against. You don't say, well, I just said, give me number 9, and I paid $3.99 for it, and it's a simple procedure. Sure, it's a simple procedure, but it comes under the bigger picture, disobedience to Allah Azza wa Jal. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلِ الْأَعْلَى. We don't liken Allah to His creation, but if someone, you know, if your boss at work tells you, for example, don't answer the phone, just ignore it, and you pick it up, you're in trouble. But you might argue, well, what happened? What's the big deal? I just picked up the receiver, and it only traveled just barely 2 feet to my ear. Sure, you can argue mechanically it wasn't a big deal, but it is a big deal considering the bigger picture. You disobeyed your boss, and we don't liken Allah to His creation. Or the chauffeur, you know, the big shot in the back of the limousine tells him make a right turn, and he makes a left turn. Yeah, he can argue that mechanically, instead of turning the wheel this way, I just turned it that way. What's the big deal? The big deal is you disobeyed, that's why. You get your last paycheck. So that's it. So you give the bigger, you get people to understand the bigger picture. And this guy, he was looking at this small process of saying, give me a number 9. But the bigger picture is you're disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب, why doesn't God appear to us and just address us directly? It was actually a professor who says, why doesn't God come on TV and talk to us? And can you imagine something so ridiculous? Alright, we have other issues. What channel is this going to be on? And Super Bowl commercials are like, you know, $1 million a second. What is this one going to cost? God's on TV. And there are going to be rights and networks are going to fight over this. But what's the bigger picture? What's the bigger picture? Fadal, Tariq.
Wouldn't they believe anymore?
No. Where's the test there? The whole idea is the unseen. You know, most of the times you see when someone gets to a point where they see the unseen, they can't repent anymore. True? Yani when Fir'aun saw the angel of death, or like for any atheist in the history of life, when the angel of death came towards them, they're like, oh, there is something. For sure, right? Every atheist believed at that point. But it's too late because you saw something from the unseen. So if God appears to someone, what would be the test in life? There would be no test whatsoever. So, and a lot of times we tell them, using analogies, which is the next point. Tell them if you have an exam and your professor is threatening you the whole year, the exam, the exam, the exam. And then you come in and the answers are on the board. Is it a test? It's not a test when you see the answers. So if God comes and appears to people and speaks to people directly, then there's no test then. What are you being tested on? If God is capable of doing anything, then why can't He beget a son if He wants to? Christians ask you that question. Is God capable of doing anything? You say, okay. Can He have a son if He wants to? Then you're stuck here. Okay. Well, He could if He wanted to. So He wanted to. And He was the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Who is it? Fadal.
It's eternal. When you define God as eternal, He can't have, can't be good or not be God, because otherwise He won't qualify as eternal God.
You're right. And from being technical Islamically, yes, you're absolutely correct. How do I get this person to see the bigger picture here? Any other comparisons maybe? Fadal. Okay, very good. So, and we'll take another sister and then I'll explain what he said. Oh, you can't hear the questions. Okay, my apologies. Jazakallah khair. I was going to repeat that one. He's saying that, basically he's explaining that, you know, the idea of having a son, this is a good thing for humans. And it's necessary for humans, you know. The son carries on your name and helps you on towards the end of your life as you're weak and so on and so forth. But this is not a quality that is good or befitting of a God. And so our answer here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only does things that befit His majesty. So you can ask other questions. And a lot of times, and we've done this before, someone will come up to you and say, well, can God have a son if He wants to? So you ask him, can God steal? Can God lie? Can God murder? Not kill, murder. Because murder is an unjustifiable homicide. So can God murder people? Can God steal from people? Can He lie? He only does things that befit His majesty. And that's the other answer to the rock question. You know. So with the rock question, the big rock that no one can move and so on, the answer there is that, first of all, you're giving these human qualities to Allah of building a rock and physically moving it. These are human qualities. So it doesn't apply here. You know. And same thing here. So yes, God is capable of doing anything, but He only does things that befit His majesty. That's why He doesn't steal, that's why He doesn't murder, that's why He doesn't have children. So, okay. Number five, you use analogies. So to explain issues and concepts, if the person still doesn't understand, use a simpler analogy. So if you give someone an analogy, they don't understand it, give a simpler one. Where do we get this rule from? Anybody? Where do we get that rule from? Yes, sir. Naam? Yes, from the Quran. Which one specifically, anyone remember? Which incident where someone gave an analogy, the guy just didn't get it, so they gave him a more simple analogy, and he was stumped. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرْ أَحْسَنْ Ibrahim alayhi salam, right? When he came to the king in Namrud, so he says, رَبِّي الَّذِي يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ My Lord is the one who gives life, and then he takes life. So the guy says, I give life and I take life. And the narration says that he brought an innocent man to kill him. And he had someone that was condemned to death and set him free. He really didn't get it, did he? He just totally didn't get the idea. He didn't get the comparison whatsoever. Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't tell him, look, well, you know, look, Allah already gave him life and you basically... He didn't explain it like that. He just moved on to something else. He noticed he realized he's dealing with a dimwit. So, right? A guy's not smart at all. So he just gave him something very clear. Okay? So this, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings the sun up from the east, so you bring it up from the west. And it's a simple argument, but because he's such a, like again, a dimwit, that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرَ and he was stumped. Yeah. So sometimes, and some people are like that, that they hear a sophisticated argument, just doesn't do anything for them. Then a dumb one, they're like, huh? You remember this with Imam Ahmad? When he tells Al-Mu'tasim, because Mu'tasim was a soldier, and he wasn't like a scholar or... He wasn't into books, he was just a soldier, you know, no brains. And so when he tells him, he all the arguments for the 3 days where they were debating him, and he was giving brilliant academic arguments, they didn't work. Which is the one that worked on the Khalifa? When he told him, I came to pray, and the Qur'an was lying dead in the corner. The Khalifa was like, how does the Qur'an die? He's like, well, that's what you say, because it's created, and everything that's created has an end. So the Qur'an died last night. What does the Khalifa do? It's a simple argument. Khalifa sits down. Qaharana Ahmad. Ahmad has destroyed us. He was telling you brilliant stuff for 2 days. This is how he destroyed you? Because he's at that level. Yani. So Namrud was the same thing. Yeah, he had to be given a simpler explanation, simpler analogy. then it worked for him. So here we are, point number five. You use analogies to explain concepts and issues. If the person doesn't get the analogy, maybe use a simpler one. Or sometimes if they don't use it, don't insist. Just move on to something else. Like, I know brothers who, they have an analogy and they love it. So they always use it. If the person doesn't get it, they try to keep explaining. No, no, the car is blue. The car is blue. You're in the car. It's rolling down the hill. Leave the car. Just move on to something else. Don't insist on your analogy because you love it. You know, you love it because it works. If it doesn't work on this guy, use something else on this guy. So, if God is good. Now remember, this is similar to the other one that we did. The flip side. You know, why does God allow bad things to happen? But now we're answering it using analogies only. So give me an answer now, just using a comparison or some kind of analogy. If God is good, why does He allow so much evil on earth? Give me just an analogy to answer this. Anybody? If God is good, why does He allow so much evil on earth? Now. Uh-huh. Okay, very good. So you're using the analogy of parents punishing their children. So they love them, but then they allow something bad to happen, like a little bit of a spanking, right? I always say a good spanking never hurt nobody, except the recipient, right? So, by the way, did you ever watch any of the crazy videos for this course? No? You watch the levitation? The coke trick? Backhanding the child, you ever watch that one? Excellent, great. So we're on the same page then. So you know what I'm talking about then. So, okay, so that's an analogy. What other analogies are there? Sisters, let's hear from you. So if God is good, you've taken Rays of Faith. You remember when he spoke, Sheikh spoke about evil? Now. Okay, very good. So if I understood you correctly, you're attributing the evil here to people, right? Not to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that's the truth. Yani Allah azza wa jal didn't just put evil. He told us the right way to do things, and then when we choose to not do it, what happens? Evil happens. So a good analogy here is the glass jar analogy. Anyone heard this one before? Like, and one time I was walking in a parking lot, it was bright outside, a non-Muslim said, yeah, I understand that, but if there is a God and if He is good, why is there so much evil on this earth? So he is trying to say, God is good, but He's doing so much evil. So I told him, and it was bright, we're standing outside. I said, if I give you a glass jar, clear glass jar now, can you hand it back to me full of darkness? And he actually said, I see your point. He immediately got the analogy. Because the analogy is saying, you can't have darkness if there's light, right? Darkness doesn't occur by itself. It only happens as a result of the lack of something else. When there's no light, you get darkness. When people choose to not follow the light or the guidance of Allah Azza wa Jal, you get evil. So you don't attribute it to Allah Azza wa Jal. So, or if the other comparison is cold, right? Cold and heat. Cold doesn't exist by itself. Cold only happens when there is no energy or no heat. That's why you have absolute zero. It doesn't get any colder than that because that's when there's zero energy. So, you can use that. Cold only happens when there's no heat. Darkness only happens when there's no light. Evil happens when people don't follow the light of Allah. So this analogy works. I just said, can you give me a glass jar full of darkness? He immediately said, I see where you're going with this. He got it immediately. Fadl. Sure, go ahead.
I think as human beings always have a question of am I doing justice? But always question, why did this happen? But am I doing the same thing? So human beings always do that. So when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I think the best way to do it is because when you do too much analogy, you're bringing down, comparing Allah to the human nature. So I think it's best to, when you ask why Allah does this, why Allah does that, as if they are in authority of whatever they do is the correct way. Because a lot of times they know this is not fair, but fair for him to do. Something you like, I mean that's fair. Something you don't like, that's not fair. So the analogy, I think, like you're saying, look at the bigger picture, that who are you comparing to? I think the better argument would be like, who is Allah? You even understand that you're questioning someone that bringing the attributes of things that you like to the attributes of Allah. Allah is doing this, so therefore...
Okay. Ahsan. JazakAllah khair. And you're actually a step ahead of us, because that's actually an entirely different technique when you talk about the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the knowledge that Allah azza wa jalla has that you don't have. What khair happens to you as a result of this evil from 10 years ago. You know, all this, it's an entirely different section, and it's very valid what you're saying. And the only thing I would invite you to do is to... because the example I gave you, we're not comparing anything to Allah, we're just explaining how evil is not attributed to Allah. That evil happens when people don't follow the light of Allah. Just like darkness happens when people don't have light. That's the only comparison we're making. And what I would like to bring to your attention is, I gave you a story where it worked. So I actually don't want you to like this technique, I just want you to accept that it could work with some people. It wouldn't be your preferred choice of argument or explanation, but I just want you to see that it could work. And that's all I'm trying to do in these 4 days, that I might give you an argument, and I'll tell you a story where it worked, and you might tell yourself, okay, it worked, but I don't like it, I'm not going to use it. Feel free, absolutely. So yes, there are other ways to explain this, and they might even be more satisfactory, and you might meet someone that's more satisfied when you explain this to them. Fadal. And this is where we use the flip side again. Yani, many times we get questions like that. The atheists will say things like, there was a mudslide in the Philippines, and you know, how many hundreds of children died? So, okay, what do you want to happen? So you want just the parents to die, and the children to remain? Is that what you want? Yani, your argument is even that, you know, adults should die, but children shouldn't. I mean, for me, as an adult, I don't agree with that. You know? So... why are you telling me it's okay if I die and if the child shouldn't die? You know? So that's one thing. So the flip side is, okay, what do you want? The mudslide happens, then the rescue team comes, everybody's dead, but all the children are just, you know, muddy and staring wide-eyed, and they're all alive, like a couple of hundred children, which now need to be put in homes and all kinds of other things. And of course, they only think of one world, especially the atheist, right? But these, they got a free pass to Jannah, these kids. That's great. They don't have to do anything haram, they don't have to commit zina or anything. They got a free pass. Yeah? So these are, there are bigger pictures, but again, you keep pushing his, extending his argument, and he's going to find out that he is asking for too much. So he doesn't want any child to die, he doesn't want any child to fall and get a scrape and a scratch on his knee or anything. And so you keep extending his argument, and he will find that he is asking for what, a euphoria or something that's impossible. So just keep pushing his thought further. Yeah? Someone else had their hand up somewhere there? How about sisters? Anyone have their hand up? We're not doing Q&A yet, yeah? But just if you're on our topic, go ahead. Yes, sister.
You're saying that eventually everyone's going to die. So regardless of the method, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stays alive. So everyone eventually will have their life taken away as soon as they
do. Is that kind of accurate? That you're saying eventually everyone's going to die? Oh, excellent. So we're only here, JazakAllah khair, sister, very good. And we're only here to go back to him. So some people go out in a mudslide, some people go out in a sports car, and some people just don't wake up, yeah? No. You
know, sometimes I explain in a way that if I poke a knife in your stomach, mm-hmm. that's an evil thing to do.
Hey, well.
When you get sick, then you go to doctor, and he'll operate you, the same evil thing that mm-hmm. you do.
Ah, I like that, okay. I like the beginning especially. It says, if I poke a knife in your stomach, you'll die. But if you get an illness and then you go to a doctor, and then he'll use also a knife or scalpel, a cutting instrument, but same kind of thing, but in a good way. Okay, very good. Excellent. But, is there a God? Well, let me just skip that one, we'll come back to it. There's only one life and there's no resurrection. How much time do we have? Okay, good. There's only one life, there's no resurrection. Using analogies only, how can you explain this? That there's got to be more than one life. Oh, let me share it with you. Fadal, go ahead. Uh-huh, excellent. So this injustice, it's a big question here. How will the injustices in the world be balanced out, is what the brother said. Excellent. You know, let me explain this from a number of different ways, yeah? I remember one... Naam, fadal Abdullah. Okay, so how can you see Allah's mercy if you don't, what did you say? Okay, if there isn't some punishment, if there isn't some bad, how will you realize the value of the good? And this is true. We all know that, right? those of you who grew up in the States and then you went overseas, you come to value a lot of things that you have here. You know that they're so good when you see so bad, right? Complain about things here, complain about roads, complain about that. Then go overseas, look at the roads, and they're like, come back, like, kiss the tarmac. Huh? This is great. So you see the bad, you can appreciate the good, right? You know, one time there was a reporter on public radio, NPR. She started to become an atheist, and she started to document her thoughts for her show. She said, the first day a voice said to me, there is no God. She said, the second day it became louder. The third day it became louder, there is no God. And I became convinced that there is no God. She said, after about a week of being an atheist, this is to quote her own words, she said, suddenly it hit me. So Hitler just died? She kept repeating it. Hitler just died? And it didn't make sense to her. That if there is no God, someone can be responsible for the death of so many people, and that's all that happened to him, is that he died. He's not going to be punished, he's not going to pay for it, he just died. You know, recently in Toronto, an atheist was telling me, you know, he's saying, yeah, there should be a reward, there should not be any reward, no punishment, so what? I told him, so Hitler, do you think it's fair that nothing happens to Hitler? And he started staring at me, and he just said, yeah. I said, you wouldn't do anything to Hitler? He's like, no, and you can tell he's lying, right? Yeah, so his first is like, you know. So, yeah, sometimes people just want to win the argument, right? And he knows his hesitation, his discomfort, he knew he didn't really believe that. So this woman, she just kept saying, Hitler just died, and that's all that happens to him? So she's actually pulling and drawing on a concept that's in the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ. Very strong verses. Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, do we equate like the evildoers, the transgressors, yeah? Like the criminals, do we equate them to the believers? Then Allah says something, مَا لَكُمْ, what's wrong with you? How do you judge? How do you judge? So if someone is doing good their entire life, then they die and they're buried and there is no life after death. And someone is doing bad their entire life, murdering and stealing, and they die, they're buried, and there's no life after death. Did they go to the same place? They went to the same place. There's no reward, there's no punishment, and that's not fair. So if someone tells you, there is a God, but we're not resurrected. We live once, we're not resurrected, then especially if they say there is a God, you can follow the following technique. You can ask them, number one, to describe God. You said there is a God, but He's not going to resurrect us. He just gave us this one life. So what is this God? What's His description? No doubt they're going to use things, words in the positive sense about God. They're going to say He's wise, He's intelligent, He's powerful, He's fair, He's just. So now this fair and just God, you're telling me, He is all knowledgeable and intelligent, and He doesn't know the concept of reward. He doesn't understand the concept of retribution. And the analogy we always use, it's an old one, yani, but it's like the child that falls down and hits its head on the table. The child will keep crying until the mother says,
bad table.
Bad table, bad table, hits the table. The child stops crying. True, sisters? The child stops crying because even this two-year-old who still cannot speak understands the concept of reward and punishment, understands retribution. And the child knows that now the table got hit the same way it hit me, the child stops crying. How can a child who doesn't speak know this concept, and you're telling me God doesn't know this concept? So that's the analogy. We tell them that if there is a God, then there absolutely must be a resurrection. Because there has to be reward and punishment. Yeah? People get away with it. Someone murders you, takes you away from your children, you don't get to see them live or graduate or get married, or you don't get to see your grandchildren. He did a lot of injustice to you. Nothing happens to him. And you don't get anything back and nothing. It's just not fair. And with another analogy, if you don't like the bad table one, you know, animals, they understand retribution, right? The monkey at your local zoo. When you offend the monkey, he flings things at you, right? If you want to know what, just go to the zoo, offend the monkey, but just take an umbrella and extra clothing, and you'll see what he'll do. He understands getting back at people, yeah? And other animals do that. Camels get back at you, right? If you mistreat a camel, he'll get a chance, he'll just grind you into the ground, he'll crush you, right? I used to always talk about another example of the bird called the honey guide. Anyone heard of that? Anyone heard this example? And this bird in Africa that when it finds a beehive, it comes to you, looks you in the eye, starts to sing and it starts to flutter its wings and it guides you to the honey. And so the idea is, you know, humans, they have means and ways to remove the honey, smoke and all that. And then after they eat from the honey, they have to leave some for the bird. That's the whole deal. You can watch it, by the way, on YouTube. To search honey guide, and you'll see videos of it calling people or calling even badgers, because they have thick fur and protects them from the bee stings. And it'll just go from branch to branch guiding people to the honey. Now they say that this bird, if you don't leave it any honey, it tells you, don't worry about it, I know another place where there's honey. And it keeps calling you again and again, and it takes you to the territory of a vicious animal that will attack you. It's a bird. It understands getting even. It understands retribution. You tell me God doesn't understand it? So these are just some analogies you can use to explain that there is life after death. There is a resurrection. If you say there is a God, then there absolutely has to be a resurrection. Otherwise, this is an unfair God. Alright, D. Why should I pray if my final destination is written? And this is for Muslims, right? They ask you this. Someone's just moping around the house, tell me, get up and pray. Why should I pray? Allah wrote down if I'm going to paradise, if I'm going to the hellfire, so why should I pray? And if He wrote down I'm going to the hellfire, I can pray all night and still go there. So, any analogies here? There's some simple ones and some Khalid Fadal. Okay, so we're limited by space and time, our knowledge is limited, and you're applying the same thing to God, and that's why you think, yeah? Like, you had your hand up?
I was going to say that Allah didn't create the track, that your car is driving on track, created the car, you know, that's the way it's going.
Excuse me. So then you're saying that, when it comes to predestination, yani?
Yeah.
Okay, so He created the human being, He knows your tendencies, He knows how you're going to behave, and He knows what you're going to do in every situation. So excellent. So now, with the Muslim, let's give two answers here. So this is an age-old question, and it's nothing new. And the scholars have answered this since 1,000 years ago. And they make a simple comparison to rizq, because your provision is written, right? Allah wrote down the money that you will make and everything. So this guy who doesn't pray, he, you know, gets up early for work and everything, and, you know, does the whole Gillette thing, and he goes to work. He works hard for this rizq. So you tell him, well, Allah wrote down your rizq. So why don't you just stay home? And since Allah wrote it, jazakallah khair, it's going to happen anyways. See, here when it comes to rizq and money in the pocket, people now become logical. So now you can make this comparison that you're saying, why should I pray? Allah wrote down where I'm going. You tell him, okay, why should you work? Allah wrote down how much money you're going to get anyways. So now he begins to understand that it's linked to your action. There's another analogy that I like very much, yeah? And I thought I invented it, then I read it on Islam QA. So I was happy, I wasn't upset. I was more happy because now I feel more confident in sharing it. I shared it with Sheikh Waleed Basuni when he taught the Qadr part. And he said he didn't like it because of this. And I said, when I explain it, I say that. He said, now you have the green light, so I'm confident in this one. So basically, this is an analogy. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. We don't liken Allah to His creation. Where we say that hypothetically there's a teacher. And this teacher, he has 3 students, but he knows his students very well. Alright? He's going to give them an exam. He knows that Muhammad is going to get 100%. Most likely, because he knows Muhammad very well. So he takes out a blank sheet of paper. He writes down, Muhammad will get 100 on this exam. And he knows Ahmed very well, and he knows Ahmed is going to get 75% on the exam. So he writes down, Ahmed will get 75% on the exam. And then there's Ali, and he knows Ali is going to flunk. He's getting 50. So he writes down, Ali will probably get 50% on this exam. He folds this piece of paper, he puts it in his drawer, the 3 young men walk in, and they take the exam. And sure enough, Muhammad gets 100, Ahmed gets 75, and Ali gets 50%. So then, the professor wants to show them how well he knows them and how he predicted what they're going to do. So he pulls out the sheet of paper and he says, you see, I wrote it down beforehand. Ali then, can Ali look at the piece of paper and say, that's why I got 50%, because you wrote I'm going to get 50%. Now, the only thing wrong with this analogy is that the teacher is guessing, but Allah Azza wa Jal has knowledge of the future. Precise, detailed, and excellent knowledge of the future. So Allah Azza wa Jal knew that you're going to get 50, so He wrote you're going to get 50. You're not going to get 50 because He wrote it. He just wrote what He knows you're going to do. So what's written about your final destination, it's not what's going to guide you to that destination. Allah just wrote because He knows where you're going to end up in. And where you're going to end up is going to depend on the series of events and things that you do in your life. And so Allah wrote that you're going to get 50,000 a year because you're going to apply for this job and get the job. But if you sleep and wait for the 50,000, it's not going to come. So that's basically the analogy. Yani. And that's why the concept of qadr, it can't be that difficult. Yani Allah Azza wa Jalla, that's why the Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah said, that Allah Azza wa Jalla wouldn't reveal a concept that's just impossible to understand for people. It's just not, that's not how it works. That's Christianity. Islam, things make sense. Things can be explained. Yeah. So, that's an analogy. The one we skipped was B, is there a God? Because basically why I put this there is that if there is a God, or if there wasn't a God, how did the majority of people on earth come to believe that there is a God? If there is no God whatsoever, how did this idea, these books and these names of prophets and the belief that there is a creator, where did that come from? And we all know the fitrah, right? So you can have people just in the wild, they believe in some kind of deity. And you've all seen these documentaries of very primitive people that can be in Papua New Guinea or this place or the Yanomami tribe, or very primitive, but they believe in God or gods. So where do they get this idea from if there isn't a God? And so, and for example, if suppose you live in an apartment building and you have no indication that you have an upstairs neighbor. You've never seen one, no one ever informed you of him, you never heard any noise from him or anything. Would you believe that you have an upstairs neighbor? You wouldn't. And so why would people believe that there is a God above unless He announced His presence in one way or another? So anyways, these are just some analogies, and let's see if we can finish. We'll do 6, that's page 64. You use stories, right? And that's obviously anyone who's given da'wah here or anyone who's called the Muslims back to Allah or non-Muslims to Allah Azza wa Jal, you use stories in explaining things or you share incidents that happened to other people. So, so for example, so I'm going to read from the notes. And by the way, sometimes I do read from the notes. And I'm saying this because some students, they're offended when you read from the notes, okay? Because they feel like, okay, it's, you know, why are you just reading to us? You know, it's like, get your own stuff and... But I wrote the notes, so it's okay, yeah? And when I did the course in South Africa, this was a big complaint. Sometimes you read, don't read. Okay. So it's like more original if I don't read, and I wrote it, yeah. Sometimes, actually, if I said it, I would say it the same way it's written, so it doesn't hurt to. So bear with me as I read, yeah? But for example, and this is... A is someone who likes to create problems between people, loves to make problems between people. This was actually a story that was used by a great scholar. And I think you guys took torchbearers, right? Yeah? So you know about Amr al-Sha'bi, great scholar, right? Brilliant. You know about Ibrahim al-Nakhai, these two are always together. Who is more knowledgeable, Amr al-Sha'bi or Ibrahim al-Nakhai? They were contemporaries and good friends. Who is more knowledgeable? Anyone know? The narration says, "Majtama' al-Sha'bi wa Ibrahim illa usakata Ibrahim." It says, any time al-Sha'bi and Ibrahim gathered together, Ibrahim would be quiet. That means Sha'bi is the more knowledgeable one. So Imam al-Sha'bi, rahimahullah, he would tell stories to adults, but there's a wisdom behind them. So he said, there's a story where the lion, he fell ill. The lion, the king of the jungle, fell ill. So everybody visited the lion except for the fox. The wolf, being a troublemaker, being aware that the fox still hasn't visited the lion, started to create problems. So he started to tell the lion, look, everybody came to you, everyone visited you, except for the fox. So then the lion started to get upset towards the fox. News reached the fox. So he came rushing to the lion. And he came to him, and he says, the king says to him, Ya Abu al-Husayn, to the fox, all the animals visited me except you. So the fox tells him, Yani may Allah rectify your condition. When you fell ill, everyone came to visit you, but I immediately ran out looking for a cure for your illness. And the king says, did you find the cure? He says, yes. I found that the cure for what ails you is in the paw of a wolf. And so the king then lunged at the wolf and tore up his paw, and the fox slowly slid out and he waited outside. So then the wolf comes out limping, and the fox tells him, oh, you with the red socks, because now he's bleeding, it looks like he's wearing red socks, yeah? Ya sahib al-khuf al-ahma. If you sit after this with the sultan, with those that are in charge, be careful of what you say, because it can come back to hurt you. So he just told this story, and what he's trying to say, troublemakers, beware, don't create problems. This applies to the office, you know, don't try to make the boss hate that person and fire him, could come back to haunt you. You know, don't try to get near, close to the governor, to the president, and make him try to hurt this person or kill that person. And if you look at the lives of imams, you find always that there's a problem they had with the khalifa or someone, and it's usually because of some snake that's near the khalifa. It tells him this person, you know, doesn't come to you, and he doesn't believe in, and he thinks your money is haram. Always some snake creating some problems. So, or example B there, no one can take the shahada after just 10 minutes of talking. So if I were to convince this Muslim, then I would just give him many of the stories. Many of the stories where someone takes shahada in 7 minutes, someone takes shahada in 8 minutes. And there are many other stories where the person doesn't take shahada, right? Or many months before they take the shahada, because it's not a guarantee. One time we were in New Jersey. And we did the workshop on a Saturday, and then Sunday we went to the streets doing some da'wah. Then we reconvened at the end of the day, and each group was talking about how many shahadas they got. We were going like this, group one, one shahada. Group two, two shahadas. Group three, one shahada. And then when it came, and I was watching this young man, he's in the crowd, and he's just watching each group and how many shahadas they have. And I saw his eyes when it came, when it was my group's turn to say how many shahadas we have. And then I asked your group, and then he was like this. And then we said zero. And he was like, what? All this talk yesterday about shahadas, and your group gets zero? Yeah, because it's not a guarantee, and it's not magic. So, it happens like that sometimes. You know, sometimes we're going to discuss the rules of giving advice, how to get your advice accepted. One time I followed all of the rules, and it still backfired on me. This sister used to smoke at the university. She was wearing hijab and everything, just like a chimney, just puffing away in front of everybody. So the sisters came to me and told me to go and advise her. I thought maybe as her older brother I can give advice, and she might accept it from me. And I started off with all the rules of giving advice. I praised her in the beginning and acknowledged all the good work that she does for da'wah and everything. Then I gave her the advice. And she let me have it. Well, I'm talking kind of stuff, you know? She was like, you are not the imam here. She just let me have it. And I remember that night I went to my friend's house and everyone's laughing and joking. I was just sitting like, they're like, what's wrong with you? Okay, I'm okay. Let me have it. But you know, so sometimes things work, sometimes it doesn't work. The good news is you get rewarded for your attempts. It doesn't matter. It's not like you only get rewarded if something happens, if someone takes the shahada, or if the Muslim actually starts to pray and takes your advice, only then you get a reward. No, you get reward anyways. Just like Nuh alayhi salam called these people for 950 years, just a few followed and believed. Does that mean he doesn't get reward for the 950 years? No, you get the reward, inshallah. Okay, we have 15 minutes and we actually finished all the six ways of answering questions. So we could take questions or we could do something else. What would you like to do? Yeah. Take questions? No. Oh, joke request in the room. Wow. You guys tired already? Or you just want to hear a joke? Okay. Alright, so Brother Khaled is insisting on a joke right now. Actually, I didn't bring my joke list with me, but no problem. Okay, there's a guy. He dialed the wrong number. This is a joke, by the way. Let me explain something, because I got this question in New Jersey. They said, you know, why are you telling us jokes? You know, isn't that a lie? So here's the idea, yeah? If I warn you that I'm about to tell you a joke, how on earth is that a lie? It's not, right? And if I say, here's a joke, one person is like, okay, this is a true story, right? It's a joke. Now, it would be a lie if I presented the joke as a true story, then it's a lie. But if I warn you that it's a joke, it's not a lie. And if it's clear that it's a joke, it's not a lie either. And if I tell you, there was a bear driving a Chrysler 300 going to work. And here, any sane person will understand, okay, this is a joke. If anyone is like, which highway was this on? That guy shouldn't be in the class, right? So that means then, when you say it's a joke, it's not a lie. And sometimes, and I understand, you will find, and you may have a sheikh that you respect, and I will respect that opinion as well, that will be a bit strict if you want to use that term. But one time, one of our friends, there was a wedding, and there was a stage, and he went up on stage, and they did a skit. And we know his name is so-and-so, and he went up, and he pretended he had a different name. He was trying to wed the guy's daughter. It was a very funny skit. It was great. When he came down, one sheikh told him, how dare you get up on stage and lie? Like, what do you mean lie? Like, you pretended to be someone else. You faked a scenario that wasn't true. Yes, but they were on stage, and we said it's a skit. So how is it, and nobody believed that, I hope he gives him his daughter. No one really believed it. So it's not a lie, yani. I know I know there will be scholars, I respect that, they say that, you know, acting is lying to people, because, yeah, but it's lying, but is it lying if we know they're acting? How is it lying? I know he's acting. So, when I say it's a joke, that means it's not a true story, it's not a lie, so don't worry. But if you don't appreciate that, I can respect your opinion, but I'm still going to tell the joke, so you just ignore this part, yeah? So, this guy, he dials a wrong number, and a girl picks up. And from her voice, he feels that she's beautiful. And I'll tell you an interesting psychological point here. Psychologists say that this is one thing that humans can almost never get right. Hear someone's voice, and picture what they look like accurately. It's almost never that way. And you know, I used to have a radio show, and when people would see me in person, they would always say the same thing. You're Kamal al-Makki? You're Kamal al-Makki? Like, yeah, I'm Kamal al-Makki. No problem with that? So he calls up, he does this wrong number. The girl picks up, and from her voice, he feels that she's pretty, you know? So he starts chatting with her, you know, macking and stuff. And so they agreed to meet. He said, where do you want to meet? So we'll meet at the juice place. So okay, 12 o'clock, we'll meet at the juice place. She said, how am I going to recognize you? He said, I'm going to be holding a glass of mango juice. And he said, how am I going to know you? She said, I'm going to wear a dress, this color, and that shape, and so on and so forth. So he goes to the juice place, you know, a little bit before 12. Can I get a glass of mango juice? I'm sorry, we're fresh out of mango juice. What? Do you have anything else that's orange in color? Orange juice? Anything? No. Only thing he found was some lemonade. So he takes a lemonade, he's just standing holding lemonade. 12 o'clock, the girl walks in, wearing the dress that she promised and everything. But he realizes she is really, really unattractive. So he's like, alhamdulillah, they didn't have any mango juice. So she walks up to him, says, aren't you Hassan? He's like, excuse me? He's like, aren't you Hassan? He's like, no, I'm not Hassan, I've never heard no Hassan. She's like, she recognized his voice, says, no, you're Hassan. He's like, no, I don't know any. You're Hassan, we spoke on the phone, we said we're going to meet here. He said, what's the matter with you, woman? Does this look like mango juice to you? Thank you for the joke manager. There are plenty of more good ones, those of you who will be with us the next 4 days. Okay. So how about this then? Khalas, we don't need to really stay until 10. How about we break? We meet up tomorrow, inshallah, 10 o'clock, bright and early. And for those of you who are still on the fence, yeah, and there's going to be so much stuff. And people will come up to me and say, it wasn't just da'wah, it was just life, how to deal with everybody, you know.
So jazakumullah khairan for being an excellent and responsive audience. Look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Sallallahu wa baraka ala Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.